Okay, here's a repair for a French customer, French YouTube viewer. Sent this in, said, can you fix it? So I don't really bother with these much, but I've done a lot in my time, so I thought I'd pass this on before I retire. Keep the stuff out of the landfill, that's the idea. SoundDock 10 power board. Comes like this, metal can on the top, metal can on the bottom, plastic ceramic protection piece here for to stop it flashing over onto the metal case. And then this customer's also sent the seal pad, is still stuck on the rectifier, wasn't it? So they can be fiendishly complicated or very simple, and I have no idea which way this one's going to go. The fiendishly complex ones do strange things like blow the FETs up after about half an hour, even though the thing's running normally, and there's internal board shorts and all sorts happen on them. But fortunately for you, 9 out of 10 probably are simple repairs. So I hope this is a simple one, and if it is, I'll just show you how to do it and what to do and what to check. All right, so this can, you have to remove these, release these dogs around here, little catches which spring onto the side and hook into the metalwork. So the first thing is to take the can off. A word of warning before you do this: if you've powered this up in the last half an hour, this capacitor's under here can be charged. So like everything else, if you're an engineer just looking for some advice, then please carry on, but beware that you might get a shock off this. There's 300 odd volts on these capacitors on the 220 volt input. You've got 360 volts DC across these caps, and it can make you jump. Right, now there's two different versions of this board, actually three. So metal can comes off, and then you've got this foam rubber part which stops it rattling on the underside of the can. There's another one that goes on the top, but he's obviously kept that in France. So I've lift that off and you can see everything is revealed. Put that over there, and here we are. So a quick overview of the what's on this board. I mean, most of you guys will know what this all is anyway, so you can skip this video if you want. But you've got the mains input socket, you've got a 4 amp fuse, which is a slow blow. To say that this is a 4 amp fuse, if you look at the data sheet, is a bit of an exaggeration, because it can sustain quite high currents for quite a long period. It's more like a type C circuit breaker. But it does blow. If you've got something catastrophic happening over here, this will blow, okay? But if you do change this fuse out, make sure you put the right type in, because a quick blow one will fail after maybe 20 or 30 switch-ons due to the inrush current here, okay? Class Y capacitors connecting 0 volts DC on the low voltage side to AC 0 volts on the high voltage power supply side. Obviously, it's, this half is isolated from that half by these opto-isolators and standard switch mode power supply configuration, okay? There are, I'll go on to that in a moment actually. So then you've got a common mode differential choke to stop the switching noise, which I think this runs at 75 kilohertz down here. But there's your common mode rejection choke, and that basically stops any switching noise from here, not any, some, most of. The switching noise going back up through the power supply and radiating out the cable. You know, it'll interfere with radios and other VHF, UHF types systems, okay, especially DAB radio. And then down here we have thermistor. I think it's about 25 ohms when you first switch it on to limit the inrush current. So that's an NTC, negative temperature coefficient, some more class Y filtering. Then the varistor, 275 volt AC varistor. These things do degrade over time. If you keep hitting them with a transient from a generator or something coming down the power lines, these do degrade. And as they degrade, the voltage reduces, and eventually they can just burn out. I have seen these where this is just switching at too low a voltage and it's blown the fuse, but everything seems intact, and it's just this. So don't rule this out. Don't expect to see it just burnt and fried up. And if there's any doubt, you should change it, really. In a service, rather than a repair, you should probably change that device for a new one, because they do, if you look at the data sheet and read the data on these devices, then you'll see what it says about the degradation over time with regard to energy being dissipated by this energy pulses. They have to be quite high intensity energy, but you know, from a generator or from a lightning strike or a main surge, it can be, there can be quite a lot of power in the spike. Okay, so moving around to here, obviously we've got our bridge rectifier. Very rarely seen a bridge rectifier, maybe one or two, but usually okay. Smoothing capacitors, good quality caps. They're made by, who are they made by? They're Nichicon Japanese. So I've only ever really seen, I've only ever seen capacitors blown up by either someone plugging 110 volt unit into 220 without moving the link. If you want to see how these are configured for the different voltages, see the previous video. They're very good, and if they're a bulb, you know, swollen up and all that, they've leaked, it means it's been over voltages, so they need to be changed. Okay, on the underside of these, if we look under here, they are mounted directly across the back of the capacitors. And a lot of manufacturers use just a resistor to balance the leakage currents, otherwise the voltages can drift out. If you've got two capacitors in series, as these are, the voltage can drift. So, and Bose's answer to that one is to fit these varistors. So they're basically two more varistors, one across each capacitor, to manage the voltage across the capacitors to make sure that they don't go out of balance. Okay, so they are... I've seen them destroyed in a couple of cases, but they're easy to test. You just need a high voltage source, a resistor and a meter, and you can wind the voltage up and then see that these start to conduct about the right voltage to test them. A couple of discharge resistors to stop you getting a shock. As you know, these will hold charge. The capacitors underneath will hold charge after you disconnect the mains. And they typically, because there's a voltage doubler, they typically run between 300 and 360 volts across both of them. So, you know, there's a lot of energy there that can give you a nasty shock. So you need to discharge those if it's been plugged in recently. Going back to the top surface again. B plus power, the smooth high voltage supply, or high voltage, but you know, 300 odd volt supply, goes through this choke, is decoupled by this row of capacitors. Never seen them failed. Seen the choke fail. Never seen them failed. And stupidly, what Bose have done is to route the high voltage tracks to the NMOS power FETs inside the board. So you do get via and shorting and carbonizing inside the board, and it can be very odd. You get some very odd effects, like it'll run for a little while and then destroy itself. And you can't really tell what's going on until you realize that, hey, you know, something's happened internally inside the multi-layer PCB. This isn't just top layer and a bottom layer. There are internal layers, and they, for some reason, Bose love putting the power on the internal layers connected by via. And as anybody who's been in production knows, the via, the plated through holes, are the weakest link, because they're process related, and if the process hasn't been carried out properly, then you end up with weak vias, and they can blow open circuit and arc. And when they start arcing, it carbonizes the resin the board's made of. Then you can get very, you know, unpredictable results. Then these two caps here, the voltage to power up the power supply before the power supply kicks in to run the provide the drive for the FETs, and also to manage and drive the comparator and the current mode power supply management chip, is derived from a resistor chain. There's one resistor there, and there's one on the other side, and a diode going in to the management chip. And the management chip, when the voltage on the input comes up to a certain level, I think 37 volts, it switches the DC output from it. It's got a rate of VCC output from the management chip, which then powers up the rest of the half bridge driver and the drive electronics, and provides enough current from these reservoir capacitors to fire up the power supply, and after which the bootstrap kicks in from a winding on here, and that subsequently provides the power to the DC low voltage side of the power supply to power the electronics. There's two values of these. I think one of the mod states is to increase the values of these capacitors, and change some links. I think they were experiencing, in some cases, startup issues with the power supply. But you can't, this modification state, because of this drive that comes through from the microprocessor over there to the power supply, there's a management waveforms come through from the micro, the main system micro on the in the SoundDock. Things like synchronizing the power supply to cut down switching noise with the D-class outputs from the amplifiers. You can't just change these or upgrade or add the put an up-issued board into a unit without updating the firmware in the unit itself. So the main other board, the sound processor board, which drives this and also receives power from this, the hardware mod state of this is depending on what firmware you've got in the sound processor. Okay. Now, I've only ever seen a few of the boards with... I think they're 33s in here instead of 47. You can see they're 47. These are 33. And if you see those, then you know, don't swap out a power board in a SoundDock 10 that's got different values of these capacitors in, because it's an older version and it won't necessarily work properly with the new firmware. Okay, so beware, these aren't all the same and they're not fully interchangeable. So check the value of these caps first as a rough guide. So moving on, we've got the high voltage DC going to the NMOS driver FET, two NMOS driver FETs in a half bridge configuration. The source of one is connected to the drain of the other, and the junction of the source and the drain is also connected to this capacitor, and this capacitor is connected to the primary of the power supply. This means that all power that's going through here, all the DC power, is transmitted through here, this capacitor here. So this is a vulnerable component, and at the very least, if you're repairing one of these, take this out and check the value. You'll find they creep down. I've had them creep right down to probably about a quarter of their correct value. When you smash them open and unroll them, you can see all the punctures and all the healing that's been going on as it's been breaking down. And in some cases, I've seen them where they're virtually so low that the thing won't start up at all. It tries to start up, but it just cannot get enough power through this capacitor to fire up the power supply. So two NMOS power FETs, very common failures. Often, only one of them seems to have blown. Often, they leak. You can measure them with a multimeter, and they seem okay, but when you fire the unit up, it won't run, or it keeps shutting down, or it just tries to start up and does that old thing where it goes and tries to start. It's because one of these two is gone or leaky. Okay, so the old multimeter test to test whether they're short isn't foolproof, unfortunately, but in most cases it pretty much is a good indication. So if you're servicing this, you need to change some of the other components, and see the other video for which components you need to change. Okay, but there's a whole bunch of things that need to be checked in here before you put the DC, the AC power back in. Okay, and we'll deal with the safe way to apply the AC to test this in another video. At the moment, this is just the overview of the actual board. Okay, right, so that's the main side, and then you've got the transformers, very high quality switch mode, low profile switching transformer from Xformers in the USA. It's a custom Bose part number, of course. They've never ever put anything in proprietary components. It's probably one of the standard ones from their range, but it's a custom Bose part number, because if you try and find this, you can't find it. I've tried before. Fortunately, to date, I don't think I've ever had one of these that has actually failed. I think they're very good quality components, actually. You got your two optoisolators, as I say. One of them feeds back the normal DC voltage to regulate the power, and the other one feeds back the control pulses from the microprocessor to the, from the low to the high voltage side. Okay, obviously there's 2 kV separation between this part and this part here. So does that cover everything? Yeah, we'll talk about these. We'll talk about these ancillary components down here, and the ones underneath this heatsink. later on the repair video, because you need a list of what to check to fix this. So if I just turn her over. Right, close up of the management electronics, located on the underside below the VMOS power FETs, NMOS power FETs, VMOS, I wish they were. So here, LM5021 current mode power supply management chip. Very common failure. If you're servicing this thing, change this and the FETs, because all three of these components are what I would call stressed components. They're subject to high voltages and they're most common failures. You can see on this one, actually, can you see that discoloration on those pins? Looks a bit suspicious, doesn't it? I wonder if that's gone as well. I haven't actually metered this thing yet, so I don't know what's going on, right? I'm just explaining what's there. So LM5021, a ordinary diode. It's just a, it's not a Schottky, I don't think. I can't remember. If you look up R74, there may be a parts list which I can publish for you. I'll have a look, see if I've got one. So this is the half bridge driver IC. It's basically a half bridge driver. There's no smart electronics in there, although there is some management which checks that the signals driving the FET gates, it needs an inverted signal to drive both FET. So there are two separate drive signals arriving on here, and this just checks that it's supposed to check that both FETs can't be turned on at the same time, because if you turn both FETs on the other side of the power FETs at the same time, you actually crowbar the reservoir capacitors, and it'll just destroy the FETs in a wink, literally in a 20 milliseconds they'll be gone, dead FETs. Okay, now so this thing here, that is, there's only one output from this, so this goes through a Schottky inverter gate. I think it's a NOR gate. So a Schottky inverting gate, and the trouble is that this is fed from an 8 volt supply. So 99%, I think, I've found that are freely available. I'm not talking about specialist orders from the factory. I'm talking about things you can order from people like RS or Farnell or CPC, are all 5 volt devices. Well, they won't work. You need the 8 volt or 9 volt devices. There's an inverting Schottky gate. So then the signals from this, the straightforward output and also the inverted output, go to here to drive the FETs, okay? And there's a bunch of components which Bose have fiddled with the values over the years, trying to tune this to get the right switching waveforms on the FETs. And of course, it's probably just the capacitance of the gates of the FET vary between different production batches, causing them to readjust this in production. And it's probably because they haven't fitted a Darlington, a high current, or a separate driver chip to boost the outputs for this to drive the FETs. Quite often you see more circuitry to drive the FET gates and dump the capacitance and get them to switch quickly. Rectifier diode for the bootstrap supply. Up here we've got a couple of, that's in series with 66 milliohms, RO66, or 660 milliohms. I think it's 66 milliohms, don't quote me, whatever they are, they might be 0.6 ohm. There's two in parallel, and they are in series with the primary of the transformer, and they're to monitor current. So generated across there by a rectifier diode and some components is the feedback voltage, and the voltage actually represents the current being drawn. So in overcurrent conditions, even on one cycle, this thing can cut back or limit so that it manages the overcurrent situation, okay? These resistors, I've never seen them blown. I've never seen that resistor blown either. It's things like the 100 ohm resistors and all the lower values, 10 ohm resistors, are the ones that blow up or get damaged. And equally, I've seen some of these transistors and diodes around here damaged as well. Interestingly, look at those. They look a bit suspicious, don't they? looks like they've had a catastrophic failure, so I'm imagining that the FET has gone on this board. I don't know. But yeah, so the bottom line is, if you have not leaky FETs, but if you have completely destroyed FETs, which are showing very low resistance across the gate and source and drain, then you, before you put your new FETs in, or after you put your new FETs in, before you power up, you need to go around and meter these components to check that they're all okay. It doesn't take that long, but it's well worth doing, because if you turn it back on again, the likelihood is the one FET will be fully turned on and you'll just go bang and the FETs will go again, and you quite likely destroy this chip and damage this chip as well. So you've really got to look at this as a suite of components which have been stressed by the failure, and change everything that's necessary to make it reliable. I've scrimped before where I've just changed the FETs and sent the boards out, but they, you know, they can fail a few months later because this has been damaged or stressed, and it really is worthwhile, you know, for the few quid it costs, just to change all the major components in here and then check all the passives as far as you can to make sure they're all okay. I'm going to do a separate video on this board, which details what to expect and where to see, and maybe some waveforms and some freeze frames and things in it to give you a complete repair guide. So that more or less concludes the power side of the board, okay? So let's go off soon. Right, so we'll deal with the amplifier side, the low voltage DC side, over the back side of the board at some other juncture. Not on this video. This is the power supply, and probably 95% of them are all to do with faults on this side. Faults on the power, on the amplifier side, are much rarer. They do happen, but they're much rarer. Okay, well that's step one. If you subscribe to the channel, there's a link in the bottom right hand side of the screen. I'll be releasing these videos within the next couple of weeks as I work through this board to hand this one over to you guys. I'm sure there's lots of capable people repairing these, but I think there's also a lot of people who would appreciate some input from my experience. So I hope you find it useful. Yeah, so look out for the videos, subscribe, and they'll be released in probably one every few days as I work through this board. So thanks for watching, and good luck with your repairs.